Now, this is something that certainly has rocked the Catholic Church. We're joined now live this morning with Archbishop Gregory Aymond. Thank you, first of all, for being with us this Easter Sunday.
You're welcome. Happy Easter.
Happy Easter to you, too. Now, when you hear of a situation like this, there are a lot of feelings attached to it. There are lots of anger and confusion. What do you tell parishioners in the New Orleans Archdiocese to see all this unfold?
First of all, I always go out in my own heart to the victims of sexual abuse, and it's very important that we as a church and as a society are there for the victims, that we reach out in a spirit of healing and reconciliation. That's the first thing. Secondly, for the ways in which the church has made some mistakes in the past, and I'm talking about many years ago in the way that we've handled some of these, I apologize, and I hope that the people of God will forgive us and help us to be purified and to do better. The third thing I think is very important, that in the last 10 years we have made significant progress and we have really changed the entire way in which we deal with sexual abuse, and especially the sexual abuse of minors. And so it is easy in a way to go back and say, well, this happened 30, 40, 50 years ago, but we're looking at 30, 40, 50 years ago out of what we know today. And what we know today about sexual abuse and that it's really not treatable is very different than what we knew 30 and 40 years ago. So, to the people of God here, I say I'm sorry, but we must move forward. This is a season of hope, and that's what Easter is. It's a season of healing and forgiveness and hope.
And to the people who've been keeping up with this story, the Vatican newspaper has denounced what it calls a vile defamation operation against the Pope. Do you think that this is partially fed by the media, or are these really events that have occurred that people should be upset by? What would you say?
Both. Okay. I think, first of all, the words that the Pope's preacher used about anti-Semitism was very unfortunate. I thought that was a poor comparison. Secondly, I think some of it is whenever people are in authority, no matter what authority, whether it's civil authority or church authority, people like to find fault, and that's part of where the media, I think, would come in. The other part is that what we went through in the United States about 9 or 10 years ago in terms of the sexual abuse and uncovering it and being purified and moving forward, it's only now that Europe and other places are going through that. So it's unfortunately reopened the wound mm-hmm. in the United States. And I think we had healed and purified. And if you look at the statistics, we have very, very few allegations of sexual abuse in the Catholic Church in the United States now. So it's reopened an old wound, and perhaps by reopening that and the pain that we will go through, we might be able to help purify some of these other countries.
Okay. We want to switch gears a bit and just talk about something, I guess, that is helping people in one parish heal. The doors this week of St. Henry and Our Lady of Good Counsel were open for their Good Friday service. Now, these are two churches that were shuttered, and let me tell you, they were not letting that parish go easily. Tell us, why did you decide to let them hold a Good Friday service, and what has been the response? What did it mean to them to be in that church, their churches?
It meant a great deal to them, and as we know, whenever one grows up in a church and family and grandparents and sisters and brothers have been baptized there and receive First Communion confirmation, it's not just, it's the community as well as the church has a special sacred significance. I have been in touch with and in conversation with the parishioners from St. Henry's and Our Lady of Good Counsel, and they have been very good discussions. I have come to admire the people very much. I think we get along very well. And we're trying to bring about some healing. They know and understand that those churches will not be reopened as parishes. But until we find a permanent use for them, the question is, can they use them infrequently for special occasions for prayer? And I have agreed to that on a case-by-case basis.
And just you mentioned healing. Talk about how, I guess, this goes, just gestures like that go a long way toward healing in this archdiocese, in the New Orleans Archdiocese, for people who really were upset about those decisions. Talk about how the healing process, you would say, is going.
The healing process began, and I think it's important to note that it's not finished, that we're still in the process, but it has gone a long way. I was able to listen to their pain and to feel a sense of that pain, and I don't think we can ever completely feel what another person experiences emotionally. But I was able to experience some of their disappointment and their emotion. And I think because of that and praying together with them, I came to a deeper understanding of what they were asking for. And what they were asking for and what was in the pastoral plan were very, very, very much in contrast. We're trying to find a middle ground. And I think with God, all things are possible.
Okay. Thank you, sir. We certainly appreciate you being here this
You're
Easter.
Welcome.
Okay. Now, the Archbishop Gregory Aymond will preside over Easter Sunday Mass. This is the Mass of the Risen Christ. It starts at 11 a.m.